Hi everybody. Trying something different. I'm going to try these headphones again, see if the microphone here actually works. Sorry about the glasses. I left my glasses in the car, which is not here at home at the present, so kind of got the mysterious aura going on. But I just wanted to talk about something, speaking of mysterious, that I'm still trying to understand and fathom, and that is based on what you've been telling me and kind of what I've seen on different groups and Facebook. This is for teachers in the Philippines, just to provide context. How teaching there is different from teaching here. So, how teaching in the Philippines is different from teaching in the US. And this may apply to other countries. Now, I know Philippines always seems to be my fallback because most of the people on the Facebook page I run are from the Philippines. I'd say upwards of 95%, maybe closer to 98, who knows, maybe 99. It's about 700, so you do the math. Anyways, so this is what I've heard, and some things surprise me, and some things, I don't know, you'll see in the end. I guess you'll be able to judge, well, you know, is it better to teach in America, or is it better to teach in the Philippines? Where do you get more support, and, you know, which is optimal for, which provides a better teaching environment? So here it goes. So what I was told was that I guess there is an allowance for a uniform. So I guess you're expected to wear some sort of uniform. And again, if this doesn't apply to everyone, but applies mostly, you know, then probably no reason to comment. However, if I'm totally off base or I misunderstood the interaction or I'm just remembering it wrong, you know, please let me know. So there is an allowance provided by the government for uniforms. And interesting that I said government because it's the federal government of the Philippines, I think. And one thing that is different from the Philippines and America is, well, there is the federal government is involved in our education. It's not involved in licensing. So each state provides a different license. So kind of, I guess, a setback if you wanted to move across a country, then you have to go through a whole series of fees that you have to pay and tests and other things to be eligible for a license or certification in a different state. It's kind of how it works here. There's no nationalization of anything that I guess would matter, you know, would make life easier, basically. So I guess Philippines one, America zero, you know, just because of the diversity of the wrong thing, right? I mean, diversity is good, but not when you have to, when it makes you have to do more work than you already have to. I mean, if you're a qualified teacher in California, you're probably going to be a qualified teacher in Texas or Florida. Just saying. Okay, so we get the uniform, I guess, allowance that you get. However, you have to provide your own computer. I've heard your own chalk. Basically, you're responsible for the upkeep of the room. And not saying that, you know, anyone's going to trash a room. I mean, that would be hopefully you're not in teaching if that's how that behavior you exhibit. And most teachers don't. I mean, you want to, it's kind of you live in your classroom, so why would you want to trash it, right? But you know, you are kind of held responsible for the upkeep, maintenance, even supplies, even I think someone said you have to provide your own computer. So you have to invest a lot and you don't get paid a lot. In the US, and this has been my experience, and again, I granted it's limited, but I want to say across the board, you know, because teachers talk to each other and unions, the people who represent us, are usually seeing what's going on here, there, and elsewhere. And there's national organizations that kind of, you know, you get a trickle down, like, oh, in this state they're doing this. Maybe you guys want to advocate that your members have this. So we have technology. Our children have access to technology. Especially with COVID, they were able to take technology like Chromebooks, you know, if that's what the school used, or laptops. You know, they had access to these things. And in the Philippines, teachers have to have their own stuff. And, you know, often really all families have are their phones. These are ubiquitous. It's kind of how you get online to the virtual world. You know, a computer is kind of something, an afterthought. You know, if you can afford it, I guess fine. You know, if not, you know, you're kind of using a phone, maybe a tablet, you know, something readily available, not as expensive, and, you know, does the job. You know, but also you don't have access. If you want to type your homework, well, I guess you're going to have to text it or something. I don't know. So just kind of something that I was surprised that, you know, given that you're not making, you know, I guess you're making enough to get by, but I don't know. I guess that would be subjective because a lot of you are coming here, so I'd have to believe that, you know, it's definitely not enough, or you probably have to live with other family members just to make, you know, stretch your monthly salary. Another thing is, so in America, you do get a living wage, you know, as a teacher. I mean, you can't live extravagantly, but you can live well, and it really depends where you live. I mean, if you live in the Silicon Valley, you'll probably be paid a little more, but you know, cost of living, you know, especially rent, that's like a huge one, right? Or housing, it's, I think it's gonna be, you'll be at a disadvantage. You probably need to marry someone who works at Google or Microsoft or wherever, so you can, you know, actually enjoy the fruits of your labor, right? Your salary. Let's see what else. Okay, this is a big one because a lot of you have been asking me, okay, well, you know, I hear so much about America. Do your kids know how to behave? And in my experience, it's a mixed bag. And I'm sure in the Philippines it is, but probably because your culture is a little more, not to say that America isn't kind of very monochromal. It's like it's, how can I say this? Really, I think in the Philippines, the expectation of behavior still is very, there's a lot of societal, communal influence, let's say, that, you know, people have to be on their best behavior and you don't act out. And it's kind of like you kind of watch out for yourself in that way. Now, some call it crab mentality. I think this is probably a positive, you know, the crab mentality. You'll think of, I mean, people from the Philippines know what I'm talking about. Anyone who's not from the Philippines, probably, what the heck is he talking about? Where you're, you know, crabs in a bucket. I think this is what the analogy, where the analogy comes from. You know, one's trying to get out and everyone else is pulling them down. It's like, no, you know, me first, me first. So this is where it kind of has maybe a desired effect, where you have that societal pressure kind of keeping everyone in line. In America, we're a little more individualistic, and you know, if you get too involved in someone's business, you know, you'll live to regret it, and hopefully you'll live to regret it and not, you know, not live to regret it. You know, people are taking their independence and individual private lives a little more seriously, probably too seriously. But yeah, so you know, if you do have a child misbehaving and it's maybe, you know, not because of a disability, because that's kind of out of anyone's control. You just have to, I mean, here in the US, through special education and other supports, counseling, we help our students in that way. I mean, it really depends on family involvement, which I think in the Philippines, no family wants to be that family that's not, you know, supporting the process of education. And I think in the Philippines, you probably value education more because you see it as a means of lifting yourself out of poverty, you know, getting ahead in life, and so on and so forth. Here in the US, I think maybe we take it for granted more than we should. And sometimes there are families, so for whatever reason, I mean, and I don't want to go into a myriad of reasons, you know, from personal experience that I've seen, but you know, it's sometimes you need a lot more patience with our students, and you know, it's not always reciprocated, but you kind of know that going in. So I think a lot of you are thinking, well, you know, do I really want to leave my lovely country, my lovely students? Kind of, you know, you share a culture, you share kind of a cultural vibe, if you will, a cultural linguistic affinity, and go to some place that, you know, or even their English is different. So the way we speak English, the way we express it, even the cadence or how we pronounce things, spell things, it's just how our language or how the English language here has developed. And you know, just that's not good or bad, it's just kind of how things are, right? So basically you're accepting a new paradigm, like, okay, well, maybe and somebody asked me this too, it just came up, you know, how do I show respect in American English? You know, because in the Philippines we say ma'am, sir, po, so on and so forth. You have those no nice formalities. I think it's a nice touch. In the US, that could be seen as overkill. If you know, you wouldn't say po because we wouldn't know what it was. You think of the river Po in Italy, or you know, if the person you're talking to knows that much of geography. So basically, kind of, it's more in the tone of your voice. We're very direct, and that's not seen as a negative thing. I think in the Philippines, when you are speaking to a superior, you show deference, but it's kind of a little more also in the tone of voice, kind of a little, maybe comes across as subservient. In the US, I go to my teacher and say, hey, Mr. K, you know, this thing came up and this is how I handle it. You know, what are your thoughts? And just kind of sharing. It's kind of more of a collegial thing. You know, even though obviously I got to show respect to the person who's going to be evaluating me or, you know, ensuring that I come back to work next year. So, you know, it's not being rude. It's just a different form of how we deal. So obviously you saw I called him Mr. K. I'm not going to say the name of the actual person or, you know, it could be Mr. K, Mr. J, Mr. P, whoever. And normally from there, you wouldn't like keep saying, well, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, no, sir. You'd say yes, no. Basically, you kind of set the tone at the beginning. And I think this is important for when you're going on interviews. It's like you don't have to kowtow to people or show them that you're being respectful by, you know, reiterating sir, ma'am, you know, throughout the conversation. It's just kind of something you need to get used to, I guess. And, you know, maybe it'll feel like, you know, you're wearing a new suit and, you know, you just got to fit into it. You know, it's going to feel like a little, got to smooth out the edges or, you know, feel like you're wearing a hair shirt. It's going to probably will feel unnatural, but it's just kind of something that kind of came to mind that was asked and I just wanted to address. Let's see what else. So we talked about students. We talked about supplies. We talked about, you know, kind of the support, material support. Oh, another thing that, you know, if something does break down in your classroom, you know, if the light goes off or, you know, the chalkboard, well, here we don't use chalkboard so much. That's kind of very passé. We use more whiteboard, so it's just markers. You know, if, you know, your marker dries up, you can requisition that from your principal, say, you know, I'm out of blue markers, you know, I need some, or the whiteboard's falling, it's probably gonna fall to the kids, we gotta do something, you know, get the janitor. So there is that support. It's not like you have to go to the hardware store, buy your own screws, come and fix it. I mean, I guess you can if you wanna take the initiative. If it's not as responsive as you'd like it to be, you know, or if it's just a hazard. But it's not like you have to go there with your toolkit and like if something happens, I'm ready. So I think in the Philippines, at least what I understood is that will be kind of your responsibility. You know, I don't know if that to that level that, you know, if something breaks, like the board's falling, you know, it's just kind of regular wear and tear, but it's kind of expected, you know, over time, things are not going to be, you know, as firmly set. For example, think of a chalkboard or a whiteboard, you know, something very heavy against the wall. At some point, you know, things wear out or, you know, they need to be replaced, so on and so forth. So I may be wrong there. I don't know if you would have to replace the whiteboard or blackboard. In the US, you wouldn't. That would be something that's kind of in the budget. They expect things to happen. You know, after a time, they may be cycling out a certain type of furniture, so you can kind of see history before your eyes. One time, or sometimes what they'll do is they'll say, hey, does anybody need a table? Go to this one place. Like the one district I worked at, it was pretty big, and on one of the sites, they had you know, tables that I needed. Called kidney tables because they're kind of half tables and they're just shaped like a kidney, I guess. And when I do speech therapy, it's just more conducive than having children sit in individual desks. It kind of gives a different, you know, it's different. I guess therapy is different than the classroom. So you kind of want to have that closeness and everyone together, but not separated, you know, that sort of thing. And so somebody said, hey, you know, these are available. Sometimes they'll say you can take it for yourself, or sometimes they'll say, and this again, experience, I guess it's different, varies from place to place, you can only use it for, you know, education purposes for your site. You know, you can't like take it home and sell it on eBay or something. But for the most part, you know, sometimes if they don't really want it and they don't want to invest in storage space, they might just give it away. I think in the Philippines, you're better at recycling things. You know, because I've seen desks from my era, kind of the old wooden desks or the ones that used to be screwed to the floor. Of course, education has evolved, and you know, we believe, I think, children should be allowed to move out a little more freely than what was the norm back in the day, back in my day. Okay, was there anything else? So we got supplies, we got, what else we talked about? Okay, support. Admin, oh, professional development. So I think the Philippines, it is provided. Now I've seen a lot of you, like you kind of showcase what you do in group, or a lot of it's online, which I think is more convenient, right? it's kind of what we've had to do. Well, especially in the Philippines, you've been in that eternal lockdown. The only way you can really group or share ideas or pool your resources, kind of your brain trust, is to go online and to just interact with each other. I know it's not the best, but but one thing I wasn't sure is, like, would you be, for example, in the U.S. we have professional days, so you have your personal days, which God forbid, funeral. I mean, these things happen, right? You're adopting, you're allowed to use those for that. So it's usually 10. Here in California, it's 10 days. 3 are sick days, and those are no questions asked. Like, if you have to go to the doctor, you don't have to provide a doctor's note. You can just call and say, I'm sick. And it could be just, you need a mental day, just kind of one to de-stress or whatever. I mean, it's all good, right? 3 days, no questions asked. Well, no questions asked. No one's going to. You just need to let them know on time so they can get a substitute to cover your class. But there's also professional days, which is if you're doing something that's going to help you be a better teacher, kind of professional development, right? So you're not going to take a personal day. Oftentimes the districts will say, okay, so you're going to be off-site. For example, as a speech pathologist, I sometimes would go to conventions, so state or local, is even national conventions, if they're in the area. The districts actually want you to go to those so you can better your practice, be a better practitioner, and that's everybody's happy, right? The better you are at your job, the less complaints hopefully will cycle down, from family, students, or colleagues, whatever. It was on a Thursday and a Friday, so I didn't get a substitute because we're kind of a rara avis, we're the unicorn of the teaching world. There's not many of us, and so it's hard enough to get us to work in a district, let alone sub, if ever we have to, leave for a day or two. And they're usually just going to say, okay, well, just double time, make it happen, make up any work that goes missing, meetings, whatever. So the district would pay for the 2 days. Sometimes they even cover, like, mileage. So if you have to drive there, they'll cover that. I think last was like 50 something a mile. Maybe it's a little more because gas prices have gone up. The last time I went, I got mileage, I think. And this was really cool. Got mileage, stayed at a really nice hotel. I mean, it was actually a new hotel. I mean, it wasn't like anything like the Ritz, but, for what I needed, place to lay my head, it was, awesome, and great breakfast and food and everything. What else? Oh, and they paid for the convention that I went to. And in some districts I went to, like one was up in San Francisco, and that was a long drive. So if I had just gotten the mileage, that would have paid for everything, but they only paid for the convention. So it really depends. But they also gave me the professional days because, I wasn't like taking a vacation. I was going to a legit professional development. So a lot of it's done in-house, and a lot of it happens during, school time. And the teachers especially, because it's easier to get subs for teachers, right? Or it was, before the Great Resignation. It's like special ed, or all the first grade teachers would go to the district or go to a regional organization like the County Office of Education to to learn like a new technology for teaching or implementing in the classroom or what have you. It was very ongoing, so I'd say almost monthly I noticed like the teachers were just going to all these trainings, and I was kind of jealous because, again, having a job that's not where it's not easy to get a sub, well, it's, you kind of have to do that sparingly. It's a little more than what the teachers could do, but you see the logic. I'm speaking to a group of teachers, so you're probably like, yay, sucks to be you, but yeah, I guess in that sense. But you're getting all that great input and kind of keeping your practice from going stale, because after a while, if you're always doing the same thing and you're not exposing yourself to new ideas, and not that you're not reading and keeping up on your own, but I think a lot of what we learn obviously comes from our experience in the classroom, but it also comes from that shared community experience. So hopefully, as the world goes back to normal, fingers crossed, that people will be able to commune again and share that great pool, those great resources, especially now that everyone's going to figure out, well, okay, I think in the Philippines it's kind of worse because, I remember when I was there, children couldn't even go outside the house for a while, and that has to be devastating to their development. But hopefully you know, together we can all kind of come up with ideas on, you know, how to, you know, help students who have been kind of in this lockdown. And, you know, for them it's probably been more traumatic because, you know, the younger population, the older population are, you know, I think we all need to be out and about a little bit, you know. It, you know, we can't just stay in the house forever, but, you know, especially just the exuberance of youth and, you know, just the older populations, they need that exposure to just newness and community and so forth. You know, so hopefully that's something that as a community of teachers, wherever we are in the world, we can figure out and share. But those are just some ideas that have occurred to me. So hopefully they've been helpful. And again, if I said anything wrong or it's like, oh, you're totally wrong, no, please let me know, because I'm always trying to learn, you know, just so I can better adapt content to the audience. So everybody take care, be safe, and just keep on teaching.